this part.
Hey, guys. Oh, man. Oh. It's like the wise chair.
Germany, Los Angeles, pretty much the same deal, right?
Well, right now it's raining. It's no different.
It all looks the same to you.
Right.
So have you been here? Have you spent time here before? You speak pretty good English, so.
Well, I'm trying to. I know I used to live a year in Ohio.
Ohio. Wait a minute. Yeah. Okay. Record scratch. What? How did you end up in Ohio?
Well, I was 15. Yeah. I didn't know it better. No, I really had a good time. I had an exchange year. I was an exchange student. That's what it's called, right? Yeah, and I ended up actually in Ohio because the organization chose for me. I couldn't choose. I wanted to go to California, actually.
I can't imagine
15,
why.
Skating, you know, playing music. But I had a great time. If I had great
Where
friends.
Where in Ohio?
So
Which part of Ohio?
North Canton. North Canton, Ohio.
North Canton, Ohio.
Right. So did you the Football Hall of Fame is right. Yeah, get right.
Yeah. So did you visit?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, I did.
You know, once a year they get a giant orange and cut it in half and they squeeze the orange on top of the Hall of Fame.
What?
You know how the Hall of Fame looks like a big orange juicer?
I don't remember.
This is all too American for you. The Hall of Fame. So have you watched American football?
No, actually not. Actually not.
So you were close, but not close enough to do that.
Pardon?
You're close to the Hall of Fame, but not enough to watch a football game.
No, I mean, I don't really get the game, you know, the rules. I'm not, you know, so if I watch it, it's like slow. I just don't get it. I'm watching soccer.
So you're a proper football fan?
I'm a proper football fan. I'm a soccer fan.
Soccer fan. Yeah. Well, see, you would call it football, no? So, yes?
We call it football, right. Okay. But to make the difference, it's soccer, you know, football.
You don't want to have to be extra polite.
I'm trying.
So when you went to Ohio, were you yet thinking about being a director or were you just kind of floating?
When I was Ohio, 15, no, I wasn't thinking about becoming a director. But, you know, as I said, I played music, and that was like my first step into art in a way.
Huh.
So, but I come from a small town, northern part of Germany. It's called Zähle. There's no media at all. You don't have any contact to media stuff. But but my friends and me, you know, we had an old camera, and we did some trash short films, but we loved. And that was actually my first step into filmmaking, but I never thought about, you know, doing it as my job.
So when was the first time that it was a reality for you?
Well, it was kind of a process. I went to, after high school, I didn't want to study because I didn't know what. Uh-huh. So I went to Hamburg, the biggest town. And I ended up like being a PA on the film set and I just loved it.
You know? So like a movie set or a commercial?
No, commercial set. I started with commercials and music videos and I very late I came feature set.
Right.
Feature film set. But I've just been there. It didn't matter for me. You know, it was a film set.
No, well, that's a lot of American directors make their moves up too. It's the commercial area and the music videos and everything are more open. So people, you hear a lot of directors come through there now.
All right. Yeah. I mean, it's a good practice. It's a good practice. And I love it. I mean, as I said, I played music, shooting music videos with bands, you know, was just great. You know, it was a playground and still is.
So you got the opportunity to go from being a PA to a director pretty quickly, or
no? Quickly? No. I wish it could have been more quick.
Well, you look like you're 22 years old. So
thank you for this. I'm a bit older, but no, it took a while, but it was good though. You know, I didn't want to hurry, and I started to edit first. I used to work as an editor. I still work as an editor. I edit my own stuff. I worked as an editor for 8 years. I just wanted to be independent to edit my own stuff, so I learned editing, and I ended up being an editor. For a couple of years, editing commercials, music videos, my own commercials, my own music videos, and I loved it. I still love editing. So this was actually my first step. So it took a while before I really became a director, but I didn't want to hurry that much because I just love editing so much.
Right.
You know.
So is this short your directorial debut, or is it?
Raju. Raju.
Raju. Yes.
It's my thesis film from university, from film school. But I shot shorts before this. Already, but this is like the biggest compared shooting Kolkata and stuff. It's like the biggest short, if you want to say that way.
The largest short. The longest short.
But it's my thesis film, so my latest short.
So after you had worked in this commercials and everything, you kind of went back to school and did your graduate work?
Right. I dropped out of work because I wanted to concentrate on the narrative. You know, I wanted to tell stories. So I decided to drop out of work and go to school again. To concentrate for 2 years on just directing, writing scripts, and being concentrated just on telling stories the best way I could do.
So where did the idea from Raju come from?
Well, I was looking for Raju, actually my first drama I shot. Before that, I shot tragic comedies. And but I wanted to shoot. Actually, I didn't want to shoot a drama. I was looking for a topic for my thesis film. So at this time when I was looking, there was this earthquake in Haiti, and after that earthquake, people took children out. They actually stole children out of that country to put them into foreign families. They wanted to do something good actually, but it was bad and wrong. You know, it's illegal because it came out that some children still had parents. They went orphaned. Right. So I started to research on that topic, and I found about this global illegal foreign adoption thing, and so it had to be a drama, of course. And I wanted to do a film about this, so this is Raju, actually.
Huh. So this is a research. You researched the whole piece. So this is not like a personal thing. You didn't know somebody who had the story, or
no. It's not a personal thing. It's really I started to research it, and it became personal.
Right.
It really became personal, and. Because I had a great NGO, it's called Terre des Hommes, who helped me researching on that topic. And it just became very personal because you started talking to people involved in that whole thing, and it really touches you, you know, and it didn't lose me. So I needed and I wanted to tell a story about this.
So how did you pick Calcutta of the different places where this kind of thing happens?
Pardon?
How did you pick Calcutta of the places that this kind of thing happens?
Well, because it came up as a spot. It's a hot spot.
This is the spot.
It's one of the spots. Right. And but it has almost good connections with the NGOs in Calcutta, so they hooked us up with them. Is it right to say they? They opened the doors for us in Calcutta, so we went over there, shot a documentary as part of the research before I wrote the script. And so that's how we ended up being in Calcutta. Just an example to make sure. It happens everywhere in the world, but Calcutta is just an example. And we ended up shooting the film there. Beautiful city, beautiful people, beautiful town, but still things like this happen.
Well, a friend of ours who's Indian, who was also director, happened to be here when I was watching your movie, and she was like, God, I love shooting in India. Because it's, you know, for everything else, all the bad stuff that's going on, it's absolutely gorgeous to shoot. It's a good background.
Well, it's a good background, but it's difficult to shoot. You know?
Because of the rules, or because there's so many people, or because
so many people. I mean, it's that they, you know, I'm obviously a guy from the Western, what's it called?
Right, like
the West. And people in Calcutta, West Bengal people, are really crazy about filming. And if they see someone, you know, like giving some direction, they know that. They're shooting a film on the street, so it takes like 2 minutes and you have like 100, 200, 300 people around you, and they won't move. You know, if you ask them politely, they won't move, which is totally okay. They just want to know what's going on. But so you have to deal a little bit with that kind of chaos. You know, it's not like you can say, okay, we blocked the streets. We didn't have that money to do that kind of stuff. So we really had to react on what's going on. We never experienced that kind of thing. So we kind of made, you know, like, this was one scene when the Wotan Wickelmoeng, the leading actor, is looking for the child he lost with a picture. No, actually, right after the child got lost, how could we shoot that film without people looking into the camera and stuff, you know, without blocking? Right. So we kind of hide ourselves in like a guy who's selling like potatoes and stuff. Like we could hide in his shop. And we discussed the scene, and Wotan and the DOP jumped out, shot that scene, you know, came in again. They recorded it on the Watchman. Then I had a look at it. We discussed it. On that time, you know, the people went away again, went out, you know, so we did like three or four times to shoot that scene to really get it done. So we couldn't like really, you know, we had to react on what's going on. You know, the other thing is we put up a camera in the car to shoot the scene with a picture. He's looking with a picture around. Again, you know. 5 minutes, 300 people. So my girlfriend was with us. She was helping us. She like acted being a star. The lightning guy like with the camera followed her, screaming, and all the people followed them. You know.
And you shot over.
They forgot about us, and we shot our scene. You know. So you kind of had to deal with this, and fortunately, you had a great crew, a great team who like was very spontaneous and great actors who could handle that kind of spontaneity.
Yeah.
What's it called? Spontaneous.
Spontaneity. I guess.
Something.
Spontaneousness is good.
Spontaneousness.
For German. It's excellent.
Take it. So yeah. So it's gorgeous. the mise-en-scene is gorgeous, uh-huh. you know, what you see, but the organization is kind of difficult, actually.
So did the crowd want money, or do they just want to be acknowledged and have a conversation? Or they?
They did. The crowd who watched us, yeah. No, they didn't want money. No, they were just interested. Huh. They're crazy about film. They're great people. You know, they didn't mean it
right.
bad or something. They was just wanting to know what's going on. I mean, I would stay there to see what's going on. So right. I totally understood that. So, you know.
Because you did it in Los Angeles, in the street in Los Angeles, you have, you know, people come out of their houses to get a check. That's how it works here, is that you have to be careful where you shoot, because they all know that it's all shooting. They know exactly
all right, yeah.
what the van's going to look like. And if they see a camera, they're like, I can get $70 if I don't turn off my TV.
Okay.
They turn the TV up and they're, you know, it's quite a little scam.
It's different there. They're just very
really
nice.
Curious. So what did you shoot the movie on?
60mm. I shot on 60mm, blow Super 16,
uh-huh.
and blow it up on the 35 CinemaScope. Like we call it a fake CinemaScope. We uh-huh. kind of put it like, you know, I don't know what it's called. We scratched like the frame, yeah. So uh-huh. so we had the CinemaScope frame, uh-huh. and so we used huh. it so we could do a blow up on 35 CinemaScope.
Right. So that was that actually more challenging than shooting on digital these days, or is that about the same?
Well, we had a long discussion, me and the DOP, because we shot in Kolkata, and they don't have a film shop or anything like this. Right. You know, we did discuss on the one hand the look, and the other hand what happens if the digital breaks down. You know, there is not a shop to right. get it repaired overnight.
Uh-huh.
But 60mm is mechanically, so the DOP guys. The camera guys could fix it in the night, so you know. So that was our one decision to shoot mechanically, actually, right. and we didn't trust the digital because yeah. it's very humid, 100% humidity, and so we really thought we go for the mechanical stuff. And also the look is just I like the grainy, yeah. you know, dirty documentary style look, flashes, uh-huh. and we had a long discussion about this, and we decided to shoot it on film.
But we actually talked to Darfung Dennis, who did Darfung Dennis, who did in Hell and Back, the documentary, and he shot with the 5D, or the 7D, or one of the Ds.
Right, one of the
but
Ds.
But he said basically because it was so, and when he was shooting in Iraq, it was so hot and it was so sandy and it was so everything that you know you can get 12 minutes out of a shot, but he got like two, and he said the camera never worked for more than like two and a half minutes. But that's how he had to make his movie. It was just he just decided it was worth it for him.
Okay.
To try
okay.
it that way, but it was like brutal apparently.
Very brutal. Yeah.
Yeah.
See, and we don't want to go. We didn't want to go through this because right. we had no chance. I mean, we had like the leading actors. What time looking when you're they're like A-listed actors in Germany. Mm-hmm. So we just had them for this. We had 10 days of shoot. They flew in the day before we were shooting. They left after the last day of shooting. So we right. didn't have any day of delay. So we there was no chance. We didn't have any. What's it called? We couldn't have any delay time.
Right.
So we had to trust the material we were working with, you know.
Now, I remember like 12, 13 years ago, there was a short film that was at, I think, Slam Dance here that was very well received and ended up, it was a short. It was a 40-minute short called Dolphins and ended up being put in a theatrical with two other shorts in Germany. It was a German filmmaker and he had a Persian-German filmmaker, but a German filmmaker. And they had ended up like consolidating three shorts into a program,
okay.
so they could put in a movie theater. Are they still doing things like that? Is that still?
No.
Is there a market for a film like this for you at home?
Unfortunately, not. I mean, the filmmakers in Germany fight for shorts before features uh-huh. right now. So you really can show, shorts before the features
right.
will be shown. You know, like less commercial, more shorts in front of feature films. So that's what kind of. People are fighting for right now, but you don't know if it's going to happen.
So it hasn't happened for your film?
Pardon?
So the commercial possibilities for your film are kind of limited by the reality of the marketplace?
To bring it out somewhere?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it is.
You just figured it would be your thesis and that was what it had to do? That was its purpose?
But I didn't
its purpose that. Was to be your thesis at school, not to be a commercial film?
The purpose was of this film, of course. Yeah. But I mean, we have a publisher and everything. So I mean, TV station. It's going to run on TV stations.
It'll run on
stuff.
TV stations.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah, yeah. The many TV stations are interested in it. And I think some bought it already. I mean, it's going to be shown after the Oscars, of course, because of the Oscar rules,
right?
Which makes sense. So, but there are many TV stations who are interested in that film, which is great.
Yeah.
You know, which is fantastic, especially for the topic. You know, we shot the topic and it got very important for all of us. And suddenly, you know, the film, what is it called? People like the film. Mm-hmm. It gets, you know, it won many awards, got nominated for an Oscar, which is just fantastic. And it's not, you know, suddenly people talk about the topic, which is just the best right. payback you could do for the NGOs who helped us, you know, for the people who work with it. It's just not, mm-hmm. well, we have success for the film. We right. also have success bringing that topic out in the world, which is, mm-hmm. yeah, just unbelievable.
You know. So when did you finish the film?
Our world premiere was just 1 year ago.
It was a year ago.
Yeah.
So when that happened, at that point, did you think, well, eventually we'll get down to the Academy Award season? Or was that the furthest thing from your mind at that point?
I didn't get this.
Were you thinking Academy Awards last January?
If we thought about it?
Yeah.
No, I didn't think about it 2 weeks ago. So, not at all. No.
Huh.
You can't. I mean, I'm from Germany. It's so far away, you know?
Uh-huh.
It's like, you don't think about this kind of. You're happy if it's running on the local festival.
Right.
And you're already happy. And if it's running on the big screen, it's just fantastic to see your film on a big screen. It's just... Yeah. You know, it's a great feeling, and you don't think about the Academy.
So it qualifies through festivals?
The film qualified through festival, yeah.
For the Academy.
Right. It won the Best Foreign Film at the LA Shorts.
Right. So then you have to do paperwork, I assume, at some point.
Well,
somebody did it.
Fortunately, the school has just a department sending uh-huh. films in, so I don't have to do it, which is fantastic.
Interesting.
So... I don't really know where they sent it in. I just received the emails. Well, you got selected or not. You know?
So when did you get that email?
From the Academy.
Yeah.
Well.
Was the nomination morning, or was there a short list?
Well, a short list first. Okay. You know, there was we won a bronze medal at the bronze medal at the foreign category at the Student Academy Awards.
Right.
In June, this was like a first contact to the Academy, which was fantastic already.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we thought, okay, that was the biggest success we could have with the film. And suddenly, I think 2 months ago, we've been on the short list
mm-hmm.
for the big Oscars, you know, and that was from that moment on, things went a little bit crazy.
And who told you on the morning of the 23rd that you were in?
Well, I've been at the Sundance Festival
uh-huh.
During that time. And the people from the Angeles Film Festival, they brought us there to the Sundance Film Festival. And they kind of made an Oscar breakfast. You know, they're uh-huh. really cool. They got up at 4, made some eggs, and made a nice breakfast, and had some champagne in case there might something happen. And so we watched all together, and
so it's a good thing you were awake, and it's a good thing you got nominated.
Yeah, it is.
You woke up at 5:30 in the morning, 6 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, I know. And, I mean, yeah, I had no idea how it works. It was my first time. I watched it live. I didn't know how it works.
Uh-huh.
I was happy we're gonna have a great breakfast, and that was cool for me.
Uh-huh.
And suddenly, bam, we got nominated. I mean, that's a film of me, and us. A friend of us filmed us watching the nominees and he added it to a 1 minute short.
Right.
And gave it to me as a present. You know, here, this is how you look like when you see that you got nominated. You know, it's kind of very sweet.
So what is that moment like? Is it over the moon? Is it take your breath away?
Yeah, I think.
Humbled?
I mean, when you're going to see me, I'm like... I'm screaming for a moment, actually. It's just empty, and mm-hmm. I just couldn't believe it because, I mean, it's the Oscars.
Have you always watched the Oscars? Is that part of your childhood?
Sometimes. I mean, it's 5 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the mm-hmm. morning in Germany, so I often fell asleep. You know, I wanted to watch it, you know, after a while, mm-hmm. just get very tired, but I watch it very often, yeah.
Mm. So how was the Academy luncheon for you?
Very exciting. I mean, being in one room with Scorsese, Spielberg, you know, Brad Pitt, George Clooney, have been there. I mean, just, you know, it's unreal.
Did you schmooze? Are you a schmoozer?
What is it?
Well, schmooze. There you go. I have to translate that one. Did you talk to a lot of people?
No. No, I watched it a lot. I talked to my girlfriend. And we watched and enjoyed it. I didn't want to annoy anyone.
Well, you must. So whose table were you at? You must have been at somebody big's table.
Well, there was the producer of The Help, uh-huh. which was great, And I actually don't remember the other ones, to be honest.
Okay. You forget Meryl Streep so easily.
Meryl Streep was just the next table.
She was right there.
Right there. I was waving.
So you feel like you're part of the club now? Do you feel, have you been whistled on board?
I have a tattoo right here. No.
That's right. Everybody gets one.
No, I'm...
Meryl Streep's entire thigh is a circle of them.
No, I don't know. And I mean, I feel like a guest, and which is a good feeling. Mm. You know.
Did you meet your other competitors? Did you meet
yes,
people
yes,
in the category?
I knew two of them, actually, and... we knew each other. We like emailed each other. Well, you got nominated. Congratulations! So, which is kind of cool, you know. You kind of get friends with the other directors of the other shorts, and So we kind of we're gonna meet tonight, actually, having a drink and mm-hmm. you know celebrating together, which is, I think, which is fantastic.
A short celebration.
A short celebration. Yeah, a short celebration.
A short celebration. And then you're actually going home before you come back.
Tomorrow, yeah. I have to work in Germany, so.
Oh, real life.
Real life.
You have a real life too?
I have real life. I have a real rent to pay.
Oh my. You should. I thought you had to stop the day you got nominated.
I thought so.
They would pay everything from now on. Well,
yeah, but your life is for free from now on. Yeah, I dreamed that.
Has somebody handed you a tuxedo yet? Or you?
We got sponsored, actually.
You really?
Yes, yes. We got sponsored by Yop.
Yop?
Yop, you know this?
Y-O-U-P-E?
J-O-O-P.
J-O-O-P.
I don't know how you pronounce it in English.
Yopes.
It's great, Yopes.
Okay. So they a clothing maker or a designer? Or
well, they have tuxedos. They don't, you know, but they, you know, arrange it to my size.
Okay.
You know, I have short legs, so they have to cut a little bit.
Things we didn't know. You had short legs.
Yeah.
So Yope has got you taken care of.
Yes.
You're already dressed.
I'm dressed.
So you'll stay at home for a couple of weeks and come back the day before or a couple of days before?
A couple of days before, right.
And have you done the circles of meetings here since you've been here? Are you a hot commodity at studios?
Well no. I did have some interesting meetings. And yeah.
Is it of interest to you? Do you want to come to Hollywood and make movies? Is that part of your idea of life?
Well, it wasn't an idea because it was so far away. You know, I mean, right. I'm happy in Germany, to be honest. I'm happy in the northern part of Germany. I'm a northern German. And... I do shoot my debut feature there, and we have great actors, great film industry, great filmmakers, and so I really feel comfortable and good to mm-hmm. make films in Germany. But definitely I would shoot in Hollywood as well. Mm-hmm. I mean...
If they put a gun to your head, you'd...
right.
You might
No, I would love to. I mean, it's just too far away still, you know. It's.
Uh-huh.
I mean, everybody probably wants to do this, so I have to stay real, you know, and I'm very honored... to be in that situation I'm right now, but again, you know, I really love being in Germany.
But you don't want to get lost in the moment of thinking too much.
Well, no, I'm just enjoying right now. You know, it's yeah. I don't making plans, and I want to inhale it all, and it's probably once in a lifetime. So I'm enjoying it.
Do you have a sense of what you want to, the kind of films you want to do as a career? Is that kind of the next piece of material that comes is the right piece of material?
Well, as long as I believe the story, I think it's cool.
Right.
You know, as long. So
but you're not like, I want to be a message filmmaker, or I want to make this kind of film.
No, it's I like comedy. I like tragic comedy, you know, not loud comedy. I like the tragic, mm-hmm. believable comedy or believable thriller. You know, I really like it as long as I go with the characters. So.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not so much into horror or stuff like this, you know.
We didn't know there actually was such a thing as German comedy until Mostly Martha. That was our first.
Which one?
Mostly Martha. She was the female, Martine Gedrick, I think. It was the woman who was a chef, and she had a kid.
What?
It was a few years ago. It was 4 or 5 years ago.
Okay.
We don't get a lot of German comedy here, though.
There is not that much German comedy, I think.
Germans are not really known for their sense of humor.
They're not known
for... Not here, no.
Yeah. Yeah, you have to see northern German films.
It's funnier.
The northern humor is really funny.
Well, I'm guessing that your generation is probably funnier than the last generation.
Maybe.
A little less cranky.
I hope so. I mean, I'm laughing a lot, so it must be funny. Yeah.
So is the German cinema business feeling very strong and stable and... like a good place to be, the German film industry?
Yeah, I mean, we don't have that much money, you know, because it's government money that pays for the film industry, actually. Or, but yes, I mean, as I said, it's the many creative filmmakers and fantastic actors. So, and great screenwriters. So we got everything to shoot good films.
And will you be very, very nervous on the night of the awards?
Probably. I don't know. I haven't think about it yet. But I think after I left the red carpet, I get nervous. That's my plan.
So you're gonna have fun on the red carpet.
I will have fun on the red carpet, getting nervous on the way to the seat, and on the seat I'm gonna sweat until the nomination. No, what is it? The Oscars.
The awards are giving out.
The awards are giving out. That's a plan, just about